Okay, so good morning. So we'll continue with our study of climate sensitivity and climate dynamics. Okay. Correct? What is that? So what is the problem we considered in the last class? Problem number 50. 50 was? The solar flux reaching the earth, F is equal to sigma T to the power of 4, where T is the equilibrium temperature, considering the earth to be a black body, that turns out to be 255 Kelvin. Therefore, what do you get? 1 by dE? dTE by dE, yeah? This is correct, but we know that this is also equal to if you look at this there is a very fine distinction. TE is the equilibrium temperature of the earth, TS is the global mean surface air temperature, okay, but the rate of change of the global surface air temperature with respect to F, that the partial D of TS with respect to F will be the same as dT by dFS in the case of, I mean, there is no feedback from other things. So basically the temperature as such is a consequence of the solar radiation coming in and the emission. That is a basic assumption. From the, then like a pizza, you add on toppings are there. Those toppings are water vapor feedback, carbon dioxide feedback. Base is something is coming, otherwise earth will not get heated at all. Something is coming and something is emitted back. That equilibrium causes some basic temperature. Now we are trying to see what is the sensitivity with respect to a change in some of these forcing. If that Fs itself changes, what happens? That is, are you getting the point? Instead of the 239 watts per meter square, it becomes 240 watts per meter square. What will happen? Okay. So everything is benchmarked with respect to the change in that Fs. So that is how we define the radiative forcing. Okay. So how much was this? the sensitivity has got the units of Kelvin divided by watts per meter square. It looks like the units are heat transfer coefficient. Watts per meter square per Kelvin, correct? And mechanical engineers will, it will ring a bell. These are units of H. Okay? Don't get confused, it is not, it is far away from the H. It is nowhere related. Okay? Viswajit had some point. I made some CRC complex kind of definition in the last class. So the Earth's equivalent black body radiation. The Earth's equivalent black body temperature rises by 1 Kelvin for every 3.76 watts per meter square per Kelvin of downward radiative forcing incident on the Earth from the top of the atmosphere. Okay? Now, all these climate change experts are trying to calculate what is the watts per meter square. Okay? Or I will just... We can leave it like this also. 1 Kelvin requires 3.76 watts per meter square. So all these climate change and climate science experts are trying to figure out if the albedo reflectivity changes, how many watts per meter square? If carbon dioxide changes, how many watts per meter square? Water vapor changes, how many watts per meter square? So you add all this, and these forcings are generally are additive. You calculate the forcing separately. For calculating the carbon dioxide forcing, you have to solve the radiative transfer equation. What is the, are you getting the point? If the carbon dioxide changes, how will the forcing change? That is not so easy to obtain. So what you do is, you'll solve the equation of radiative transfer in the atmosphere with 390 ppm and get one value. Then with 395 ppm or 400 ppm, you'll get a value, and then find out how this changes with respect to, so I will tell you later on that there is a relationship called ln of C by C naught into something. That is how it changes with respect to carbon dioxide. So you'll have to do, or you have to take controlled air, you have to do ice core measurements. You have to go deep into Vladivostok, you go to Vladivostok, where, somewhere north, high up, right? You go to Vladivostok and then drill whole kilometers into the snow, then get the ice core. In that ice core, air will be trapped. Then there is a dating formula. We will find out for that depth, what will be the time period. In that time period, that air will contain carbon dioxide. Find out what is the carbon dioxide concentration in the atmosphere at that point in time. Then the universe, the funda that carbon dioxide concentration is universal, then you apply that. Whatever is in Vladivostok or whatever is the same in Velachery. Okay, then you reconstruct the carbon dioxide concentration, though you don't have direct measurements before 1945 when some Keeling set up that biggest laboratory to measure carbon dioxide in Hawaii. Is it okay? That's how they, these are all hardcore, all scientifically established. No, it is not like alchemy or somebody's astrology or something. It is not like that. So this carbon dioxide concentration, people are, because normally when you say, how are you confident, people who don't understand, no, they will say, how are you confident, how did people measure carbon dioxide, 100 years back, where was the instrument, 200 years back, where was the instrument, all that air is trapped now, I have instrument, then archaeology or paleoclimatology can never be studied, man has found out ways of studying the past, all right, so this is a very important this thing, so something like this is called radiative forcing. So two things, for 1 Kelvin it is 3.76 watts per meter square, And we are talking about radiative forcing, not forcing by wind, forcing by convection. Radiation is very important for climate. Convection, winds and all this pressure distribution and all this orography, topography, all these things are land breeze, sea breeze are important for weather. What will happen in the evening, what will happen in the afternoon, all that is weather. But compared to 20th century, what happens to 21st century, 22nd century is a bigger picture, is a bigger problem. So, here radiation has to be taken into account. Okay, now this is fine, let us get back. Though we solved the problem in the last class, I think now you have understood it better, right? Okay. Marius, are you done? I think you went all over the place. You are not to be seen.
Yeah.
Bharat Darshan.
What?
You figure out. You ask him. You get, you do Delhi and Bombay Darshan if you are on a flight. Because normally the, it's very difficult to get ATC clearance. So you will keep on circling Bombay, right? Free. Time is lost, but all right, okay. I promise to you, I will teach at least 2 hours of atmospheric dynamics, but I forgot to realize that there is a very important lecture on climate change, which I will have to, which is a fast-paced PowerPoint presentation, which I will have to deliver tomorrow. So, we are just left with only one lecture for the atmospheric dynamics. I will quickly give the governing equations and some simplification and tell you two approximations, the cyclone approximation and the geostrophic approximation. We will solve a simple problem and then close the course. That is a plan on Thursday. Tomorrow's plan is to bombard you with the PPT. Okay, I will convert it into PDF and send it to you. By tomorrow, I will also send you the PDF which gives the schedule, whatever, from 9 o'clock to 1 o'clock. 1 o'clock, Sai Rahul will come, I think, 12:45 or. This cloud seeding, two people are coming, two groups. So, 10:15 and 10:30. So, I will, everybody has to be present. Okay, you just cannot afford to come only for your presentation unless you have some, this exam, that exam and. So, you are at your creative best. So, if it's a genuine reason, it's okay. Why are you late to class? Brilliant expression of creativity. Why are you late to class? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, it'll just come like it. Missiles. Okay? Profs are just thrown off guard. How creative students can get. All right. Now, this we are looking at, so, DTS by, this is the lambda, right? Yeah, what is the equation number for this? 1, was it 1? We wrote it in one of the earlier classes. 2, okay. Okay, now, see, y is a, Ts is the global mean surface air temperature, okay. F is the forcing, okay, flux. So, this is this. DTS by DF is how much the temperature will change if for a given change in the forcing, that is a lambda, that is a climate sensitivity, right? So, we are qualifying the whole of climate with just one quantity, what is it? TS. And climate sensitivity by one more quantity, which is? Lambda, okay. Climate means global mean surface air temperature. Sensitivity means with respect to forcing. This has to be understood. So, this is the partial D is partial TS to partial F is basically when there are no feedbacks. Plus, you add the feedback, but the feedbacks were including auxiliary variables. These auxiliary variables are carbon dioxide, water vapor, clouds, all those things, okay. Now, this dy I by df can be taken to be this, okay, na? This is just some playing with calculus, partial differentiation, okay. Therefore, plus sigma it's too much, huh? Okay, all right. Okay. This is called the feedback factor. It is qualified by subscript I, where I can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1 could be water vapor, 2 could be snow cover, 3 could be cloud cover and so on, okay. Now, and F equal to therefore, okay. So, is it okay? So, we are able to relate. If we are able to calculate all the feedback factors, get the sum of the feedback factors and call that as F and find out 1 minus F and then do the simple dou Ts by dou F divide by 1 minus F. You can find out the climate sensitivity. Of course, this equation will cup if F equal to 1. That is all right. That is okay. But now, some equation number for this. So, this is lambda naught. This is lambda. Correct. Lambda is the sensitivity of the climate with feedback. Lambda naught is the sensitivity of the climate without feedback. Therefore, lambda by lambda naught should be what? Conceptually, it is a gain. It is G, right? what is the climate sensitivity with feedback divided by what is the climate sensitivity without feedback. So now from equation 10 it is clear that G is 1 by 1 minus F. Now provided F is less than 1. So F is greater than equal to 1, infinite sensitivity, unstable. The challenge is to be able to calculate this F. So you can use your zero order model, first order model, second order model and whatever. You can use your full CFD, radiative transfer model and all this. If you do all this, calculate these feedbacks and give projections, then you are a climate science or a climate change expert. Okay? All right. So much about climate sensitivity. Okay? But we have not studied one thing so far. Whether it is the atmosphere or the ocean, it has got a finite inertia. Whether it is the atmosphere or the ocean, it has a finite inertia. Or you just change the forcing by another 2 watts per meter square, next second will the temperature change. So there is something called the transient response and the equilibrium response. Even if you change that instantaneously, solar load is changed instantaneously, next second the temperature will not become 255 because there is a MCP of the system, of the atmosphere. Are you getting the point? There is an MCP of the ocean. Correct? There is a thermal inertia. So we'll have to look at this response. So then we have to solve a initial value problem now. So the most simplified approach will be considering it to be a first order system. Okay? Let us consider a simplified first order system and then proceed. Okay? So this will be transient versus equilibrium response. What do you mean by this F much, much greater than 1? Even small changes in the forcing can cause large changes in the temperature, which have a highly unstable equilibrium. Okay? I don't think we are in that situation now. As of now, we are not in that situation. Okay, it won't happen tomorrow or Wednesday or before the end sem. Okay, so transient heat capacity of Earth is very large. Hence, TS shows a delayed response. To what? To change in F. Correct? This is the first point you have to understand. So this is called the adjustment time. Okay? For the atmosphere, it is a few months. for the ocean mixed layer. Take a guess. Seventy-one percent of the. It's a few years. It takes a few years. It doesn't mean that we can be irresponsible. What we are saying is, it won't happen overnight. Continental ice sheet. It will take several centuries. Okay. Now, we're going to consider an example. We'll consider ocean mixed layer. Okay, so I'm not going to consider layer wise and then make it a big complicated problem. There is a M, there is a Cp, there is a temperature. Okay. You have a baseline temperature of T naught and the temperature increase or fluctuation is the T dash, the change. Now we are going to write a equation for this. So okay, this is okay. Okay, so T dash, the transient response to forcing. Which is the forcing? Which is the source term? Ah, correct. Okay. So if you are at a loss to understand what is going on, okay. So if you are not able to conceptualize what is going on, you take a bucket of water, you are heating it in the hostel, for example, you want to take hot water bath. There is a dipper heater, okay, it gives you a heating input of Q. Okay, so this has got a mass of M and Cp. This mass can be heater plus wall plus water and all that. Let everything be at one temperature. Now it is also losing heat by convection, na? Plus radiation also. Let's neglect that. So the equilibrium response of this will be MCp dT by d tau equal to Q minus HA into T minus T infinity. As it starts getting heated, this temperature will increase, therefore it will lose heat by convection. But heat is continuously input. So the curve, it will go like this. When it reaches a steady state, this term will vanish. That will be the equilibrium temperature of the bucket. If it is more than 100 degrees, you are finished. When will it become more than 100 degrees? You switch on without the water. Okay. Otherwise, you can do your math and it will come to 80 or 85 degrees if you are using a 1 kilowatt. I give this problem in one of the courses, right? Which one was that? You forgot, huh, Vishwajit? Heat transfers. Okay, one of these courses. Now you are able to, instead of the heater, we have some change in carbon dioxide or something. Instead of this water in the bucket, we have water in the ocean. Okay. All right. So, you want to be able to solve this? lambda is whatever your gain. Okay, so we can bring the equation, we can lambda is the climate sensitivity. Okay. Yeah, please solve this.
Why is the minus term there? First term. Why is T value? What
is that?
Why is it negative sign? The same equation. Minus T by lambda.
Yeah, because the forcing term will be positive, this will be negative, isn't it?
But lambda will take care of the sign, no?
No. You solve it, we will see. Now, please solve this equation. Let's do, I will answer your question. Let's, okay. Okay. Now, let tau be MCP into lambda. Therefore, plus Q dash by what will be right hand side? Q dash by tau.
Into lambda by tau.
No problem. So please solve equation 3. It will consist of two parts, the complementary function and the particular integral. So then I'll answer the solution will answer your question. So you can also have it as Q dash into lambda by tau. You can keep it that way also. Correct? Particular integral is? What is the particular integral for this? Q dash into lambda? Is it? Go figure out what is this particular integral. That particular integral, if you take the derivative, the first term will vanish. And if we substitute, then left hand side will be equal to right hand side. Then it is a particular integral. All right? Is it correct, Sneha? I am believing what you are saying. Okay. Therefore, can we proceed? Okay. So, T dash. How do you get A now? A is a constant. At time t equal to 0, what is t dash? At time t equal to 0, t dash is 0 because it is equal to the initial temperature t naught. What is t dash? That is why that minus t dash by this thing is coming. Now you got it. If there is no forcing left to itself, this will decay. Understood? Okay. Fine. So at t equal to 0, A plus therefore Q dash lambda okay. So there will be a rapid response initially after some time. Depending on the time constant, there will be a slow response. When t tends to infinity, we thought that if you apply a forcing, immediately it will reach q dash lambda. That q dash lambda will take a long time. That t equal to infinity is few months for atmosphere, few years for the ocean, few centuries for the continental ice sheet. Okay, that is a characteristic time. Are you getting the point? So any first order system will behave like this. So if you put the thermometer in the mouth, doctor will not get the temperature immediately. For him, he has to wait. His time constant is 2 minutes. If you put a thermocouple, you will wait for no change in reading for 10 minutes. You will say it should not change by more than 0.1 degrees. 10 minutes you will wait. Some experiment will wait for hours. So there is a time constant for everything. Doctor will not get the exact temperature at the end of 2 minutes. You will get a reasonable temperature. Anyway, it is Dolo 650111, isn't it? Whether it is 101 or 102. Okay. All right. So this is nice, right? So you got how the response also we have seen. We saw the sensitivity and all this. Now what about the feedbacks? I will give you some stats, climate feedbacks. And then we will solve a problem and close. Water vapor. F equal to 0.5. People have calculated. If F equal to 0.5, G equal to 2. Very good. So that you understood. Okay. Next. Cloud. Clouds contribute to greenhouse effect. If the cloud cover is more, then whatever radiation is going, watch what I am saying very carefully. If the cloud cover is more, whatever radiation is coming back from the earth, this cloud will intercept it and it will not allow it to go out. Okay. So the cloud will continuously build up, but correct? That is what you are thinking. But there is a, the cloud will also reflect the sun's radiation from the top. If there is no cloud, everything will come, isn't it? So the net effect is 0. Clouds are not causing climate change. Otherwise, big anti-cloud movement would have taken place. So, is that okay? The cloud also created by nature, no? Why unnecessarily we have to trouble? So, net cloud forcing is, I am not going to write it down. Net cloud forcing is, there is some cloud computing also, right? So, G is 0. Okay. So, clouds are harmless. Ice albedo feedback. It is very small, it is not a cause for concern. There is something called snowball earth, where the earth, when it is a tipping point, this ice albedo feedback can make the whole earth freeze. But we are not at that tipping point now. At some point, who is taking the snowball earth? If you reach that tipping point, they will present that everything will work in such a way that the feedback will, it is an infinite do loop, it will repeat and this thing, and then the earth will keep on, it will like crazy, it will build up ice and snow and all that. But now we are not there, so we are fine, okay. So, no worry. So, the national logo of Australia, you know, is, you know, t-shirt, what they wear. No worries, Australia. No worries, Australia, right? So, no worries, ice albedo feedback. Now, carbon dioxide feedback is dangerous. It positively contributes to GHG, greenhouse gases, and people have figured out. If CO is your initial concentration and C is your is a new concentration, 5.35, that is arrived by radiative transfer calculations. So if you do that, then you have to add that F and then calculate the lambda and then you will calculate the G and so on. Okay. Now, problem number 51. Estimate the apparent climate sensitivity. Estimate the apparent climate sensitivity The apparent climate sensitivity is given by what do you mean by this? Ts at the temperature Ts at one point in time minus another point in time divided by F at one point. This is like the Desi way of, otherwise you have to get the curve and then calculate dy by dx and then. So it is an apparent climate, okay. Estimate the apparent climate sensitivity based on differences in Ts and F. Based on differences between Ts and F between the current climate. Based on differences in Ts and F between the current climate and the climate 20,000 years ago. And the climate 20,000 years ago called LGM. The 20,000 last glacial maximum. Okay, with the following data. Ts current minus Ts LGM is 5 degree centigrade. Okay. CO2 LGM 180 ppm. CO2 LGM 180 ppm. CO2 now 360 ppm. Okay. Change in albedo 0.01. That's all, only two effects. So, can you proceed? You can calculate this del f, okay? So, numerator is how much? 5. So, the challenge is to calculate the denominator, okay? There are only two feedbacks, carbon dioxide. How will you calculate the carbon dioxide feedback? 5.35 ln 2. How much is it? Okay. Correct, huh? 342, isn't it? Correct. Sir, how did you get this 342? Okay. 239. What is that FS, huh? 239.4, huh? What is the albedo of the earth? 0.7. So, incoming is 342. But what is contributing to sigma t to the power of 4 is 342 into 0.7. We have done this again and again in the problem. That results in 239. Okay. So, out of this 342, if again changes by 0.01, that is 3.42. So, please add this. So, you are all becoming climate change experts now. Given the data, you know how to calculate. But this is coming from some model and all that, you can improve your models, you can consider interaction effects, okay, and then you can look at all these changes over 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, you can put your current consumption of oils and this thing and CO2 emission, all that, then it will become a stud model. Now we are using a very simple model, okay. 5 by 7 point, okay. This is 0.7 what? That's all. So what do you infer from this? G is. We solved the problem number 15, no? It was 0.266 without feedback, right? That is 1 by 0.266 gives 3.76 for 1 Kelvin. So, this is the gain or the amplification of this, the amplification of the sensitivity because of feedback. How much is this? Huh? How much is it? 2 point? Okay. So, in simple English, due to the two feedbacks, the apparent sensitivity increased 2.6 times. What was an original value of 0.266, which is coming because of solar radiation. Now two things have changed, the reflectivity or the albedo has changed, carbon dioxide has changed. So if they are going at this level, then we are in trouble. But this is 20,000 years. The time we are talking about is 20,000 years, 5 degrees centigrade. But now next 5 degrees centigrade, many things will melt. We lose surfaces, we lose continents, we lose countries and so on. But it may happen much more before 20,000 years, because if it has taken 20,000 years for carbon dioxide to double from 180 to 360, now it is doubling at a mad rate. 360, now it is 390 already. In calculations, we are doing 390, 400. So, tomorrow I will show you a plot where carbon dioxide last 100 years, it just goes like this. So, all this. So, this 5 degrees is not a great thing, but the time is coming down. Okay, that is the problem. I will stop here. Tomorrow we will run through a presentation. I will give you a PowerPoint on climate change, and then we will wind up the course on Thursday with just a very brief one lecture course on dynamics.